show that Coke is serious about movie and we are trying to have as many product placements as possible. And this is my next message, is that actually Coca-Cola has a very strong heritage in the cinema and it dates back from more than a century. So I'll share with you a bit of history of Coca-Cola and the movie because I found all those archives and I think it's nice to have a look at that. So actually it all started in 1905. Where at that time, at the theater, there were already Coca-Cola to be sold for 5 cents. But funny, interestingly, it was after the movie. People were not drinking during the movie, but after the movie. Then 1 century ago, there were already 3D glasses with Coke branding. 1927, first sampling program, and we were already trying to use Coca-Cola to drive admissions to the movie. So we were endorsing a film with Charlie Chaplin, and as you can see, there was a free Coca-Cola bottle if you go to the movie on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday in the morning. So it's a kind of Orange Wednesday a long time ago. Same in 1928, again, it was about sampling Coca-Cola to promote the brand, but also to drive admissions to the movie. In the 30s, there were famous actors in Coca-Cola advertising, including Clark Gable. And then in 1947, the first concession stand was built in New York, and that was a big change. The industry discovered that actually by selling beverage, you could make a lot of money. In 1950s, the first combos arrived. The idea was to put them together, sell more of both, and that has been very successful. So we, as from that time, we were already trying to push combos. So actually, we are not inventing anything today. The first fountain equipment is back from 1952 in cinema, and then you had plenty of point of sale material to communicate about drinking during the movie, combining that with popcorn, and they go for a top quality show, they expect top quality refreshments. In the 16th, we had the first pre-movie trailer encouraging moviegoers to drink while they were watching a movie. I won't show it to you because it's really old. More point of sale material during the 60s. And then the first strong tie-in promotions with big movies. There was Star Wars, Superman 2. So again, this is nothing new. Did you know that in 1982, Coca-Cola won an Oscar? Actually, at that time, Coca-Cola owned Columbia Pictures, and they got an Oscar for Gandhi. So Coca-Cola has received an Oscar a couple of years ago. Then you see evolution of the point of sale material, Angel the Show, and then more strong tie-ins with big movies like Harry Potter, like Matrix Reloaded, Avatar, Skyfall, and more to come. And last year we had a in-cinema advertising called The Swap, encouraging consumers to move from Coca-Cola regular to Coca-Cola Zero, and that had been shot in a cinema. So with that, we see that Coca-Cola has a strong relationship with cinema, also with the studios, and thanks to that, Coca-Cola today has a strong position at the global level. We have an 88% share of screen in the US, while you may know that in the US, market share between Coke and Pepsi is about 50-50, but clearly Coke is over-investing in the US in order to have this significant market share in cinema. And in Europe, we are in good shape as well, with about 85% market share. And I think it will be easier to show you the exhibitors which are not partners than to show you the ones who are partners. So here you have a quick overview of the circuits who are not working with us across Europe. So I still have a bit of work to do. So in a nutshell, we have a very strong heritage. But where are we today? Well, I think that we are in a strong position in Europe because we have a very strong legacy. But today we are maybe not innovating enough, and maybe we lack that kind of magic and innovation. Just to give you a few examples, we do have 3D advertising, but we do not use them. We should do something with Dolby Atmos, clearly. So there are plenty of opportunities where I think Coca-Cola should go the next level, and this is high on my agenda. And clearly, the message is that we need to keep innovating to deliver more value to the cinema industry. At Coca-Cola, we use the word constructive discontent. And this is our CEO. This is a quote that he uses very often. You see him here smiling, but most of the time he's not happy. He said, we need to be always unhappy and trying to have more. So this idea of constructive discontent, not being happy because you want to improve the situation. So the topic of today is driving cinema retail growth in a challenging environment. So it's a bit funny to be talking about a challenging environment when I'm in Norway, where I think the macroeconomic situation is pretty unique. There is no unemployment. So it's very it's easier for me to talk about a challenging environment when I'm in Spain, Italy, Portugal, Greece. But in Norway, clearly, there is no challenging environment as such. Well, when we look at cinema industry, I think still there is a challenging environment. First factor is that admissions are decreasing in Norway. We had yesterday a fantastic session on forecasting to see how the year 2013 will close in Norway. I'm not going to review the numbers, but I got that it will be down around 9%. By the way, those are the numbers I have from a Dodona report, which may be different from the numbers that we have seen yesterday. But anyway, we are going from 12 million admissions to around 11 million admissions. Second factor is that has also been discussed yesterday. We have a decreasing admission of young among the young population. So we see that the young people are not so keen to go to the movie anymore. And this is, of course, very worrying fact for your industry. We do face the same, actually, Coca-Cola. We also see that young people drink less and less of our beverages, and this is a key concern for us. And that's why we put so much energy and resources in what we call team recruitment. We want to make sure that we always recruit the next generation of drinkers. Why? Because we know that once they start drinking our beverage when they are young, the consumption of sparkling beverage decreases over the time. So if we can increase the consumption when they are young, we will keep them drinking more during also the whole life. And that's exactly the same with movie going. If you drive teen recruitment and if you have more young people going to the movie, they will keep going to the movie during their entire life. And this is also what they will share as an experience with their kids. And it's going to be transmitted generation after generation. Third issue is that there is a fight for share of wallet. Clearly, consumers today have so many options on how to spend their money that they have to make choices very carefully on how they spend their money. This is why we see increasing smuggling, people choosing for home entertainment rather than going to the movie, because they want to make sure that the way they spend their money delivers the most to them. And finally, we also see that consumers are becoming more and more difficult and asking for more and more. And what we see is that most cinema circuits across Europe are delivering less. Why? Because they have to implement new strategies to cope with today's environment. Let me explain that in a few details. First, we see that overall in Europe, admissions are down. So the industry do not really believe in growth anymore. Previous growth strategies have been the following. If we cannot drive admissions, what we do is to increase the prices. And again, today, in today's environment, I'm not sure that the industry feels very comfortable about increasing the prices. So if we summarize, admissions are not growing, and you cannot increase the prices anymore. So what can you do? Well, what you do, and that's something that we have seen yesterday as well, is consolidations. We've talked a lot yesterday about consolidations, and clearly there is more in the pipeline. But also another factor is that cinemas are looking more and more to operational efficiencies. And what we see in some countries is that the cinema experience is decreasing because of those operational efficiencies. Actually, the almost only lever that you can, and cost that you can decrease is staff. So we see in many circuits, I think it's in continental Europe more, that cinemas are cutting costs on staff, so that when you go to the movie, you don't have people cleaning the auditorium between two screenings, you have popcorn everywhere, You have no one to welcome you, so you don't see staff anymore. And clearly, this has a negative impact on the total experience. And that leads also, in some countries, into a trust deficit. In some markets, we see that moviegoers feel processed when they go to the movie. When we hear some of their quotes, they see, I feel processed, they just want my money, it's rip-off. And in some countries, clearly, we reach a point where there is a trust deficit and people do not enjoy going to the movie as they did a couple of years ago. And we know that trust is so important. We live in a period where there is already a big trust deficit in different levels, whether it be banking sector, food, or any other or political concerns as well. And we know that when people trust a brand or an industry, they are happy to spend more and to pay more and to buy more of the product. So trust is so important. And we see that, I give you two examples. This is one example for beverages. Here we plot different countries and we measure actually how people trust the brand Coca-Cola. And on the other axis, you see what is the consumption of Coca-Cola in all those countries. And we see that there is a clear correlation between the trust in the brand and the consumption of our products. And for sure, it's the same with movie going. If people trust the industry and have a good feeling, they will go more to the movie. Another example, this is a quote from 2006, tired, irrelevant, unloved. And actually, that's referred to McDonald's. A couple of years ago, McDonald's was in very bad shape. They had a trust deficit. They measured that, and they did a few things to improve that and to fix that. And you see here on this chart, the yellow line is actually the trust index. And you see how it has increased massively for McDonald's, and you also the direct impact that it had on their share price. So in a nutshell, trust is key if you want to develop a sustainable business. So key elements of trust is to be honest, transparent, stable, continuity is important as well, to build relationships and caring with moviegoers, quality, competence, vision and values, and development and innovation. And then to drive trust in cinema, how could that translate into cinema? Honesty and transparency, that could be talking about ingredients, talking about local sourcing, talking about calorie counts. This being said, I'm not sure that moviegoers are so interested in calories when they go to movie. Relationships and caring, that's showing what you do for the employees, for the local community, what you do in terms of charity, opening your cinemas to disabled people, and so on. This is also helping to build trust for the industry. Quality and competence, I think that's all about the state-of-the-art technology so that you give the best experience to moviegoers. And then development and innovation, I think that's clear for everyone. In the cinema industry, this is a key point on your agenda. And I love this chart. Would you please elaborate on when something bad happens? Because in some countries, cinema industry is in bad shape as on this chart. But usually you notice when it's too late. That's why I think it's important to have that in mind before it's too late. Tonight.